C4 and Bryan Nehman.
WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
I've made very clear that this commission should not be meeting until the Attorney General has the authority to remove a member of the commission who is clearly violating the mission and values of said commission. So my position is clear. We will make sure to advance this legislation. I will sponsor this legislation and request for this to be considered an emergency bill. And we will give the Attorney General the authority to remove a member who is violating the norms of this commission so that this commission can carry on with its vital mission.
That is Maryland Delegate Democrat Joe Vogel, who is from Montgomery County, speaking with our own Robert Lang yesterday here at WBL News Radio about the Hate Crimes Task Force that was his creation. It was his bill. It just got created this year. And the member that's on that board, Bryan Nehman, in the audience, that Zainab Chaudry, the director of CARE, the Council on American Islamic Relations, and her comments, her statements, her posts, all of that, that have been deemed to be anti-Semitic and not worthy of being on this task force. And they can't get her out, Bryan. Mm-hmm. Can't get her out because the Attorney General, Anthony Brown, says the rules don't allow them to do that. So the delegate is saying, at least don't meet again until we're able to get this done. Joining us in studio, because I really thought this was an opportunity, we talked a little bit off air, to really delve into this, particularly from the perspective of him being a former chairman of a committee, state senator, but also the fact that he's Jewish and can speak to this as well. Former State Senator Bobby Zirkin joins us here in studio, Bryan. And Bobby Z, good morning to you, former
senator.
Good to see you.
Good to see you guys.
Yeah. Awesome.
Nice new studio.
Let's talk about the task force first and then make it a broader discussion about other issues. But here you have a task force that is deemed with looking at hate crimes and trying to, you know, be brought, and a member of it, and you're very well aware, Senator, with CARE, right?
And of course.
And the organization, and the statements that they made, and yet you have not only this member on your task force, you can't get rid of them, and it seems like people are quiet. Where's the governor on this? Where's the president say, where's the Speaker of the House on some of these issues?
I don't know the answer to that question, but what Delegate Vogel said is 100% right. I mean, I don't even know that this is, the statement, you said that the statements she's made have been deemed to be anti-Semitic. Right. I don't think there's any deeming. They are anti-Semitic.
Okay.
She is anti-Semitic. I mean, she is a bigot. I don't know any way to say it, right? I mean, the nuances that you hear people trying to say are outrageous. Like, she is an anti-Semitic bigot. How she ended up on a hate crimes task force, I have no idea.
It's astonishing.
She is
it's like a walking bill.
I mean, listen, let me just say this. She's a walking hate crime against Jews. It is what it is. I mean, I don't know who appointed her to that. I haven't, you know, I didn't follow Delegate Vogel's bill, and I didn't follow, you know, Anthony Brown's task force, but whoever appointed her to this, I mean, you really got to start thinking about what is going on in society and in our own government. I mean, I'm sure we're going to talk about this, but, and I know you did before, but CASA of Maryland,
yep,
or the city council and what they did just a few days ago. I mean, it is the things that are going on college campuses, mm-hmm, including ones that are here in Maryland. I mean, it's just, it is an outrage to see this, like,
the rise
outpouring of anti-Semitism, yeah, is just outrageous. How, I mean, how she got on a hate crimes task force. I mean, I remember her from when I was in office. It's like, these are hateful people. So how they ended up on a hate crimes task force, unless they're like, you know, bearing their soul to the task force.
Well, it's
or
language.
Something.
It's actually language in the bill.
Yeah, CARE has to be. CARE has to have a seat.
It's really disgusting. Yeah. I mean, it's disgraceful, shameful, whatever word you can come up with. I mean,
all right, so for me, I'm fascinated to get your perspective on this.
Sure.
I'm not Jewish, but I have to tell you, I've been shocked at what I've seen since October 7th.
Yeah.
Absolutely blown away, shocked. Oh, my God, what is happening? It started with the stuff that went on college campuses. It has spread now to other areas. You know, the both sides-ism that has been happening, quite frankly, at the government level now these days, and what we saw in the city council, they can't even condemn Hamas. I mean, for crying out loud, if you can't condemn Hamas, who can you condemn?
Right.
Right? Has it surprised you, or did you see this somehow coming?
I mean, you always knew that there was anti-Semitism in the world. It just, I grew up, I guess, a little bit sheltered. I mean, I didn't see it when I was growing up in grade school or high school and college. You know, I went to Johns Hopkins. I mean, it just, I haven't experienced it. I mean, there have been incidents in my life where I experienced it, but the amount of it, the volume of it, the ignorance that you see from people, I mean, to have, you know, I mean, just to return to CASA and the things that are college campuses, for people to be chanting from the river to the sea, I'm certain that most of these morons chanting it don't know what
they
it
don't.
Means.
47%
But for the ones who do know, that literally means kill the Jews
murder.
In Israel. Murder, genocide.
Yes.
That is literally what it means. You have a member of Congress, Rashid Tlaib, who's chanting it. Like, if that person can't be expelled from the Congress for calling for murder, who can? I mean, George Santos was kind of a joke and got expelled and, you know, committed crimes and all the rest. You have a sitting member of Congress from my party, I guess, saying, I mean, that's not my party. Listen, anything that people like that are that's not me. That's not my party. I will never associate with bigots like that. But chanting for the death of a group of people. Can you imagine what the Democratic Party and what the squad and all these, you know, these other folks would say if they were chanting for the death of, say, African Americans
or
Native Americans or transgender? Exactly. If you had a group of people chanting for the death of transgender people, what would you hear from them? Oh my God. And listen, I am not a fan of Donald Trump. I think he's
You've been clear before.
You're not a fan.
I mean,
he's
a horrible human being.
Yes.
And what he said after the Charlotte stuff was reprehensible. And you heard that from, you know, lots of people. That is the same exact thing as what Rashid Tlaib did. In fact, I would argue that Tlaib was worse, calling for the death of people, right? Both of them are horrendous. I mean, where have we come in politics?
Well, I want to stop
where
you there.
Where have we come?
I want to stop. Former Maryland State Senator Bobby Zirkin is here, also an attorney. And his, you know, watching this made him want to really come and speak with us in the audience about the climate that we face. Let's get down to CASA, the Maryland,
sure.
And to the city council and Barton a little bit. Here you have a group, Gustavo Torres, I had him on the show, executive director of this group, that put out some things so horrible in social posts that all of the Jewish state senators in Montgomery County initially signed a letter asking that that group not be funded. Mm-hmm. Then you saw it expand to other members of the legislature who weren't, some weren't Jewish, some were. How does this turn, like, is it funding? Like, how does this begin to turn this? Like, are these groups need to be isolated? What needs to happen? Because I can speak as a member of the civil rights family. When it came to what we did in the civil rights movement, we began to isolate groups that were racist, isolate individuals that were speaking like this.
Well, you're already seeing a turn to be like, well, they apologized. Well, let's sit down with them. I mean, your listeners should know that their tax dollars, their money,
yep.
is going to this group which espoused on social media, I mean, you know, they're out there for everybody to see, for the genocide of citizens of Israel. They put a post out on social media that says, from the river to the sea, which is exactly what that means. And
now, is this CASA of Maryland,
CASA of Maryland.
That's what I thought. I want to make sure.
Millions of dollars of your tax dollars goes to a hate group. Let me just say again, can you imagine if the KKK
yep.
was doing things for whoever, and people would say, well, they do nice things for this thing, even though they're a hate group. I mean, and they were calling for the genocide of African Americans. There would be less than a 0% chance that the General Assembly
Absolutely.
Would fund that group. And of course you wouldn't, right? Of course your tax dollars wouldn't go there. CASA does things for the immigrant community in immigration and so forth. Some of them are fine and good. But so do a lot of other groups that don't get money, right?
Right.
There's lots of immigration
That's
lawyers.
That's like Mrs. Lincoln, the plane was okay, but we shot your husband in the head. You just because you do a few good
That's
things
right.
doesn't excuse this.
So the idea that they get one penny of tax dollars, like, it is reprehensible. And good for the senators who signed that letter. But you saw what happened afterwards, right? The ACLU, one of the who are not the ACLU. It's
no,
not your
not.
Father
it's
or mother's
ACLU. It's a liberal advocacy group.
It's an advocacy group, and it's worse than an advocacy group. It's one of these, like, you know, guerrilla advocacy groups, G-U-E-R-I-L-A, guerrilla advocacy groups who do nothing. They go to people's houses. They make idiotic statements about the law. They came out and said that the General Assembly, it would be unconstitutional, says the ACLU, for the General Assembly not to give money to CASA.
Right, right.
That is the most asinine argument. I said to one of the senators called me and said that they had said that. I said, well, why don't you ask them for, I don't know, a case
yeah,
that says
thank
that?
You.
What is the case
right.
that says you're required to give a group money from the state budget other than for education, which is in the Constitution?
Back. These groups, Senator Bobby Zirkin, hope you don't say what you're saying. They hope people don't fight back. And the members of the city council the four that would not sign on with the other nine members of the city council on a resolution that was as basic and broad and specific enough that you said, we want to condemn Hamas, the attack on October the 7th, and anti-Semitism. That's what it said.
Right.
That's what it said.
That's all it said, too.
Yes.
That's right. And certain members of the city council blocked its passage. Why would they block its passage? I mean, they came up with an excuse afterwards. I got a letter from
it took
one,
them a day and a half to do it.
Right. I mean, they were like, and the letter is, I have a copy of it. The letter is like struggling to figure out a reason why they did that. It's just ridiculous. I mean, I'm not saying that the people who blocked it are anti-Semitic. They're just, I don't want to.
They're
unfiltered
foolish.
Cowards.
But
for like the liberal groups, cowards to the left fringe of the Democratic Party. That is what has happened to my great Democratic Party. Is they've become cowards to the left, to the worst elements of the fringe. And don't get me wrong, for all you Republicans out there, so are you, because you've become cowards to the right fringe. The idea that Vivek Ramaswamy is on a debate stage with somebody as good as Nikki Haley is an outrage of epic proportions. The idea that they can't condemn, that on the right, you can't condemn what is obvious criminal activity by Donald Trump. It is not even a question that what that guy did is criminal for any of the rest of us. So the fact that the right can't condemn that is also outrageous. Let's get back to the Democratic Party, because I'm not trying to do the whataboutism. Let's get back to what we're talking about. The Democratic Party and members of it, real like people that are in power, have become cowards to the left fringe. And it needs to stop. It needs to come back to the center. That's why I like people like Larry Hogan, right? I love that guy. Not that I agreed with everything he said. Not that I agreed with every policy. But he tried to work together across the aisles. Bill Clinton did the same thing. Like, there are people and good people in both parties that really want to work together. And I think the majority of Americans are like that.
But on this issue, why can't we be united to stand up for anti-Semitism? And that, to me, is the issue. It's like, I use racism, Brian, as an example. The 60s coalesced this country to understand that segregation was wrong. Racism is wrong. And I didn't think we'd have to have discussion in 2023, Brian, but we have to actually discuss, can you stand up against anti-Semitism?
I made my views perfectly clear about this. I mean, it is so obvious to me where the wrong is here. The wrong is with Hamas.
Of course.
And I, for the life of me, don't understand how left-leaning people in this country want to support what would be a regime in a country that would be illiberal.
Right.
They would be anti-women. They would be anti-gay. They would be anti-democracy.
You'd be executed.
Yes. So why in the world would you ever wrap your arms around something like that? It has never made any sense to me why they are in favor of that. And yet they go around and they, you know, obviously they want your pronouns to be right. They want to make sure that there are certain people who look like this in this group and representing. And yet they will support Palestinians or the movement or whatever it is in the Arab world that is anti-democracy, right?
Anti-democracy, anti-LGBTQ. I mean, like, the best was seeing, not the best, I mean, just ridiculous. You see this picture of a college kid wrapped in a rainbow flag supporting Hamas. Like, go ahead and explain to them how supportive you are. You should go there and enjoy yourself in Gaza and see how long you last there. I mean,
it's like saying blacks for the Klan is what it is. I mean,
exactly,
it's really
it
like that you would think that you would be welcomed in a Hamas governed country. It's crazy.
The fact that we're even having to have this conversation is ridiculous. For the college kids, they just don't know history. Like, we actually had somebody at my Thanksgiving table. Somebody came who was one of these individuals who was like crazy left-leaning. And so we started getting into a conversation and she says, well, we need a two-state solution. I said, well, great. I said, that's really great for you to want that. That's because you're an American elitist. But like, you know who doesn't want that? Hamas.
Right, exactly.
They're not interested in that. Mm-hmm. And by the way, neither were the Palestinians.
Right, so the moderate Palestinians didn't want it either.
Right. I mean, like, they actually had that on the table. For those who like don't know or don't care about history just a little bit, in Maryland,
yeah.
they were offered that, right? You yep. remember the Camp David yeah. Accords.
Hillary Clinton laid out, and the best, Brian and I played the clips, when she was on The View, laid to the shock of The View women, who, of course, are supportive of a lot of stuff, laid out the history that she was in the room for to watch how those accords were broken
That's
by
right.
the
Palestinians.
She laid out, the whole,
Yasser Arafat. Yasser
she laid out
Arafat.
The whole history.
Yasser Arafat had got every, they it was Ehud Barak and Yasser Arafat. You had the Oslo Accords, and then you had the Camp David Accords. They were offered, they being the Palestinians and the Palestinian, I guess, Liberation Organization, yeah. whatever they're called at the time, were offered everything they were asking for. They had East Jerusalem as a capital. I mean, all the things that they say that all these, you know, American left elitists say that they want for these individuals, they were offered it all. And Arafat turned it all down mm-hmm. and decided to create an intifada anyway, which, by the way, for all these college kids who are talking about intifada, that means blowing up buses with kids on it. And that's what intifada means. So when you chant intifada, which some of these idiots are doing on college campuses, that means just go murder people. That's what that means. So like,
well, a little bit of history, though, Bobby. I mean, I do remember crazy. When intifada did start in 87, and part of it also was the fact it was uprising. It was an uprising because of something that happened with the Israeli police force in the Palestinian territories. And I understand that what intifada means to some extent, but there is another part of it, which means uprising, to deal with a response to an attack that occurred. But I want to ask you, because we've got to close on time, and that is, do you intend your voice being more prominent on this? Because I believe, Bobby, your voice, even though you're an attorney now, doing the things, is needed from the perspective that you have. Not elected, I'm talking about, but just needed.
Yeah,
to
talk my wife's not letting me run for anything. I thought you were going there.
No, I wasn't.
My wife would have my head.
No, but just to speak to these issues.
Yeah, I mean, I'm trying to.
Particularly
Listen, if there's ever a forum for me to do so, I will. Like, there's a lot of people that are trying to. You know, APAC, and there's professors that are going out and trying to explain to kids on college campuses, trying to educate them and all the rest. Like, it is very difficult, right? It is very difficult, and I hate to, like, sound like people that I used to run against and so forth, but, like, these college campuses have been inundated with these left-leaning individuals. I mean, it's just nuts what's going on out there. So the answer to your question about what I would do this anytime. I am trying to. I've spoken to legislators after the thing about CASA came out saying, you know, basically you better damn well not give them a penny next year. I mean, I'm watching that one because if CASA, if my tax dollars goes to hate groups, then there should be hell to pay. I mean, so the answer is yes. In every way I can possibly do so, I will. It's not, you know, it's hard to figure out what the best way to A,
we'll
educate people. Mm-hmm. I mean, some of my good friends, and I am going to bring this up, like Rashid Tlaib, right? When you have members of Congress who are chanting from the river to the sea, they should be expelled from Congress. What is worse is that my good friend, and he is a good friend, I love Jamie Raskin. However, to hear him defend her when she was being censured was as like heartbreaking to me as can be, because I know how he feels for real.
But
right?
this isn't politics. He's
but that's
politics.
Politics. And it's so disheartening, because I really, you know, you and I both at a young age got involved in politics, yep. ran for office. I cared about making policy. What is going on now, watching like this like rush to the left and rush to the right, and seeing, you know, individuals who I greatly admire and respect, like somehow doing this whataboutism, and it's really
we
got to
end it here, Bobby Zirkin, because of the time. But we definitely right. think this is an important discussion to continue.